professor and I'm the president of the Federalist Society here at Ohio Northern. I'm so pleased to be with you this afternoon and to have the chance to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Gordon S. Wood. Dr. Wood is joined today by Professor Scott Douglas Gerber of our own College of Law. Dr. Wood is the Alpha O Way University Professor Emeritus at Brown University. He is without question one of the nation's leading historians. He is the author of many works, including The Creation of the American Republic, 1776 to 1787, which won the Bancroft Prize and the John H. Dunning Prize in 1970, and The Radicalism of the American Revolution, which won the Pulitzer Prize for History and the Ralph Waldo Emerson Prize in 1993. The Americanization of Benjamin Franklin was awarded the Julia Ward Howe Prize by the Boston Authors Club in 2005. His book, Revolutionary Characters, What Made the Founders Different, was published in 2006, and The Purpose of the Past, Reflections on the Uses of History, was published in 2008. His volume in the Oxford History of the United States, entitled Empire of Liberty, A History of the Early Republic, 1789 to 1815, was given the Association of American Publishers Award for History and Biography in 2009, the American History Book Prize by the New York Historical Society for 2010, and the Society of Cincinnati History Prize in 2010. In 2011, he was awarded the National Humanities Medal by President Obama. He has received many other awards as well, and he will be receiving an honorary degree tonight from Ohio Northern at the Freed Center for the Performing Arts at 7 p.m. Dr. Wood will be exploring the revolutionary origins of the Civil War tonight. Today, he and Professor Gerber will be discussing the Supreme Court and the uses of history. Finally, he is also a fascinating person, and we are all in for a treat today. Now we'll begin with Professor Gerber, followed by Dr. Wood, and end with a period for questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Zach. First of all, I'd like to thank Professor Wood for kindly agreeing to this extra session. The main event, if you will, according to President DiBiasio anyway, is tonight at 7 at the Freed Center. And as Zach just mentioned, he's going to be speaking on the revolutionary origins of the Civil War. But he was kind enough to agree to do this because I wanted the law students to have a chance to interact with him in our building on a legal topic. And he was nice enough to do that. And he also was nice enough this morning to meet with John Lomax's historiography class. So I'm really grateful that he's doing all this for us. And I do strongly encourage everyone to come to tonight's event because it'll be very good. And after the event, at 8, there'll be a book signing, and he'll sign his books, and they all win major prizes and the like. And books make nice gifts and stuff, and my family's asked me to buy some and have them sign them, etc. I'd also like to thank, of course, Zach for putting this together because it's a great turnout, and it was a lot of work, as we both know, to do this. I want to thank Hope Smalls and the SBA for being uncommonly generous with the money to feed everybody. The National Office of the Federalist Society also kicked in more than they usually do, and also the front office here in the law school was kind enough to give us some money, so I appreciate all of that. A few years ago, I debated Larry Kramer, who's the dean of Stanford Law School, and so that's a big job to have, and he's a famous person. A year or two ago here, I debated Sandy Levinson about the Obamacare issue and the constitutionality thereof. And as folks might remember from that, Sandy had won the Lifetime Achievement Award from the American Political Science Association. And so now I have to debate Gordon Wood, who Zach has mentioned has won every major prize you can win, including the Pulitzer Prize, which is not easy to win, believe me. The President of the United States gave him the National Humanities Medal, which again is not a regular occurrence, I'll just say that. And so I'm not sure what happens next year or the year after that, because that's as high as you can get in academia. I did note that yesterday we got a new pope, so maybe next year Pope Francis will be. and I'll have to get my tail whipped by him. So anyway, as Zach pointed out, what we're going to talk about is whether Supreme Court justices or judges in general should consult history when deciding cases. And the reason that Gordon and I decided that I should go first is because I wrote a book about it. It did not win the Pulitzer Prize, but still, I thought it was okay. And so I can frame the debate, and not unimportantly, I talked directly about Professor Wood's work on the American Revolution in my book. And so it's really an honor for me to have him here because, and I'll say this tonight at the Freed Center, no one, and I'm not engaging in hyperbole here, no one has had more influence on my own writing than him. And lots of people can say that. And he, you know, and I'm not alone in saying that, as you'll see later. So anyway, well, thank you for that. And so my first book was called To Secure These Rights, The Declaration of Independence and Constitutional Interpretation. And so my answer to the question whether Supreme Court justices should use history to decide cases is a qualified yes. And this is what I mean by that. My argument is that they should use history to identify the political philosophy of the American founding and then decide cases in light of that political philosophy. I call my theory liberal originalism, and as Zach knows, there's no idea that the Federalist Society is more committed to than originalism. And I call my theory liberal originalism. It's liberal in the Lockean liberal sense that the principal purpose of government is to protect individual rights. It's originalism in the sense that I argued that the framers wrote the Constitution with that principal purpose of government in mind. To secure these rights, the Declaration of Independence proclaims, governments are instituted among men. And in my liberal originalism label is kind of a play on words, and since this was my first book, my PhD director wrote a foreword to it, and I'm sure Gordon's written a lot of those. And this is what he said, in short, Gerber advances a theory of constitutional interpretation that will likely displease both modern liberals and modern conservatives, a sure sign that he is onto something. So that's what he's one of the courses I teach is a seminar on constitutional interpretation. And in that course, I've come to the not surprising conclusion, and I suspect that every person that's taken con law comes to this conclusion as well, that all of these theories of interpretation in terms of reading the Constitution depend at their essential level on political philosophy. Justice Felix Frankfurter said it best, constitutional interpretation is not at all a science, but applied politics. And my choice for applied politics is the Lockean liberal political philosophy of the Declaration of Independence. Why? Because it was in the Declaration of Independence that the founders articulated the political philosophy upon which our nation is based. And so I will now just read you the paragraph that we all learned in grade school. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by the Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, denying their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. And just for your information, Clarence Thomas agrees with that proposition, at least in civil rights cases, and I promised my students I won't say anything more about Clarence Thomas than that. And so did Thomas Jefferson, who wrote the Declaration of Independence, so did President Lincoln, the great poet president, and so did the Reverend Martin Luther King. in his I Have a Dream speech, which is the most famous speech of the 20th century. And here's the important point for us here. Professor Wood's first book, the one that won the Bancroft Prize, The Creation of the American Republic, agreed with the proposition that the nation was founded on the basis of political principle, but denied that the principles upon which the founders reached consensus were the liberal principles of Locke. Instead, Professor Wood and Professors Balin at Harvard and Professors J.G.A. Pocock at Johns Hopkins articulated a, quote, Republican interpretation of the founding, and Republican not in the political party sense of the word, but in the political philosophy sense of the word. For scholars such as Professor Wood, the basis of the American Revolution was not a philosophical concern for protecting private rights. It was a widely shared commitment to sacrificing private interests for the public good. And that was such an important argument that I'll just read you what a leading political theorist said about the importance of that. One student of American political thought has gone so far as to call the fall of Lockean liberalism and the rise of classical republicanism in the historiography of the American Revolution, quote, arguably the most stunning reversal in the history of political thought. And so he's the person in large part responsible for that. So the first part of my book is trying to make the case that the Republican revisionists, such as Professor Wood, neglected the Declaration of Independence, the document that articulates the official political philosophy of the American regime. In fact, one of the first articles I ever published, an article I included in chapter one of the book, was called, this is the title, Whatever Happened to the Declaration of Independence? Subtitle, A Commentary on the Republican Revisionism and the Political Thought of the American Revolution. Okay. Now on to why it matters for the Constitution. In the second part of the book, I try to demonstrate that the framers wrote the Constitution to help effectuate the principles of the Declaration of Independence. For example, James Wilson, who was second to James Madison in terms of contributions to the Constitutional Convention of 1787, quoted the Declaration at length in the Pennsylvania Ratifying Convention, and then said, quote, this is the broad basis on which our independence was placed, and on the same certain and solid foundation, this system, the Constitution, is erected. I explore in the book how other intellectual leaders of the American founding felt about the connection between the Declaration and the Constitution, and how the principles of the Declaration were reaffirmed in the Constitution's preamble, the Bill of Rights, the Federalist Papers, and the early state constitutions. Obviously, I don't have time to run through in detail that. I'll just give you an example. Nearly all of the state constitutions framed and ratified during the founding period made express reference to the basic purpose of government being to protect the people's natural rights. The reference was usually in the form of a separate Bill of Rights, or in those state constitutions not containing a Bill of Rights, in a section, typically the preamble, reaffirming an allegiance to the natural rights principles of the Declaration. In fact, New York simply quoted the Declaration at the very beginning of its constitution. Now, just a word about conservative originalism, since that's what the Federalist Society believes. Just to oversimplify it a little bit, that's the idea that Supreme Court cases should be decided the way James Madison felt about a specific issue. So they appeal to the specific intentions of the framers, not to the general principles they committed the nation to. And so conservatives like the late Robert Bork, Justice Scalia, etc., Steve Calabresi at Northwestern, who founded the Federalist Society, etc., regard a jurisprudence of original intention as the only legitimate approach to constitutional interpretation, because only that can give us law that is something other than and superior to a judge's will, and only that will eliminate the anomaly of judicial supremacy in a democratic society. Despite the methodological appeal of the conservatives' argument, in my judgment, their campaign for a jurisprudence of original intention should be seen for what it is, a quest for political results. Analyzing the conclusions to which the conservatives are led by originalism reveals that they are simply espousing politically conservative interpretations of the Constitution and labeling them original intent. In effect, the conservatives are substituting conservative result-oriented jurisprudence for liberal result-oriented jurisprudence. For example, and I can only give you one, for conservatives to argue, as Chief Justice Rehnquist famously did in one of his dissenting opinions, that the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment does not prohibit the majority acting through the political process from authorizing prayer in the public schools, is to rewrite history in the founders' political philosophy. It is difficult to imagine a principle to which the founders were more philosophically committed than the separation of church and state. Of course, my criticism of conservative originalism did not win me many friends at the Federalist Society. I was a man without a home for a while there. But eventually, folks accepted Randy Barnett's point that there's a polite divide in the Federalist Society between libertarians such as myself and Randy Barnett and Richard Epstein and Reagan Republicans in the Federalist Society. I'm the former. The vast majority of the Federalist Society is the latter, including, as I mentioned, one of the founders, Steve Calabresi, who clerked for both Judge Bork and Justice Scalia. And I'll end with this. Because I advocate a version of originalism, and again, originalism, as you remember from Con Law 1, is reading the Constitution through history. And that's why it's nice that Professor Wood is here, because he's a historian. But because I advocate a version of originalism, it's necessary for me to attempt to answer, albeit briefly, the chief criticisms leveled against that interpretive method. There are four primary criticisms, and I'll just walk you through very quickly what they are and my response to them. The first is the framers could not and did not anticipate many modern needs and problems. Champions of the, quote, living Constitution emphasized this point. Justice Brennan was the leading figure in this regard. And so in the 80s and 90s, when originalism was all the rage because of what Reagan generation was doing, Justice Brennan was criticizing it. The way that a liberal originalist avoids that criticism, however, is to adopt Ronald Dworkin's famous distinction between concepts and conceptions. So what a liberal originalist is interested in is the concept, not the conception. In other words, we want to know what the principle is that the court should be applying. We don't care about the conceptions that Madison or Wilson or any of those people had about that concept. We don't care what their specific views were on race and gender, for example, because they were not good, right? But if you just apply the concept of equality, you can reach different results. The second major criticism is this, that it's impossible to determine what the framers intended. And this criticism has two iterations. The first is that modern Americans cannot understand what the framers meant because our language is different from theirs. To be blunt about it, that's nonsense. It's quite feasible to understand what the framers intended at the level of philosophical principle that embodied in the Declaration of Independence. The second iteration of this criticism is that there's no single entity that can be called the framers. It wasn't just Madison, in other words. And the response to that from a liberal originalist would be that the general convention that framed the document and the state conventions that ratified it shared the same intent on the fundamental question being addressed, namely, what is the principal purpose of government in the American regime? So the problem faced by conservative originalists is not shared by liberal originalists, because we are concerned with discerning the framers' intent at a relatively general level of social consensus, that of natural rights philosophical principle. The third criticism of the four is the integrity of the documentary record. And James Hudson, who at the time was the chief manuscript officer at the Library of Congress, was the leading proponent of this criticism. And this is what Mr. Hudson said, that the records that conservative originalists need to identify what the framers wanted us to do have been, quote, compromised, perhaps fatally, by the editorial interventions of hirelings and partisans. So in other words, that Madison made himself look better than he should have, or that he left out stuff that other people said, that kind of thing. What a liberal originalist would say is that the documentary record is sufficiently reliable to reveal that the framers intended the Constitution to be interpreted so as to secure the hard-won fruits of the American Revolution. And the last criticism, and the one I'll end with, is this, that the framers did not intend the Constitution to be interpreted in accordance with their intent. In other words, they didn't want us to do what they wanted to do. And on that theory, or that criticism, conservative originalism is a sham and illusion, someone once said, because it lacks historical foundation, and the very notion of original intent depends on history. But critics of this type, in my judgment, overlook the importance of discerning the philosophical principles motivating the framers and the obligations to which those principles gave rise. English writer G.K. Chesterton made the point nicely when reflecting on his voyage across America in the early part of the 20th century, and this is what Chesterton said, quote, "The American Constitution is founded on a creed. America is the only nation in the world that is founded on a creed. That creed is set forth with dogmatic and even theological lucidity in the Declaration of Independence, perhaps the only piece of practical politics that is also theoretical politics and also great literature. The Constitution, in other words, is a political document in the noblest sense. It establishes a framework of government through which certain underlying philosophical principles are to be advanced. And those philosophical principles are the natural rights principles of the Declaration of Independence. To ignore this fact is to ignore the reason we are a nation." So with that, I will stop and turn it over to Professor Wood.
Well, thank you. And I'm pleased to be here at the law school talking about the Supreme Court and the uses of history. I have no doubt that the Supreme Court should use history and will use history. But there's no doubt in my mind also that it's not really history that they use. It's not the history that historians write. And it's impossible, and I would go beyond that and say it's impossible for jurists, law professors, and Supreme Court justices or judges anywhere to really use history. It simply would not work. So judges have to invent another kind of history. We call it law office history, history light. It's a necessary fiction, and I don't consider that to be a bad thing. It's a necessary fiction for judges and other jurists to get along with their work. They need some kind of history to work with. History is much too complicated to be used effectively by judges in the courts. Let me give an example. A distinguished historian, I won't name him because apparently this is going to be recorded. He called me up last week and he'd been asked by the New York Times to write an op-ed piece on gun control. You thought the op-ed pieces in the New York Times came from above. I mean, from below. They come from above. He called me up because he doesn't know much about the Constitution. and he wanted to know what I thought about this. And I said, you're out of your mind to write this thing. I said, the history is too complicated. And if you make it simple to, because he's a good liberal, and he wanted to take the good liberal position that the Times wanted. And I said, if you do that, you'll just hurt your professional standing. I mean, it hasn't bothered a lot of other historians to do that, but he was a little taken aback by that. But he says, but I'm a citizen too. And I said, that's fine, you are a citizen, but when you write and they list your credentials, you're writing and using those credentials to assert your point. I said, look, this, I don't want to mention his name, I may do that by mistake, but I said, the people back then had no idea, could not have imagined in their wildest dreams the debate we're having over gun control, whether it was over the Second Amendment, whether it was the militia or the individual. Those issues which have filled law reviews and many historians have participated in it, I think wrongly, because they couldn't imagine that debate. They simply didn't draw that distinction. They could not even begin to imagine that we would have a debate about gun control. So how can you go back to the history except to cherry pick and pick out phrases or words that seem to fit your agenda? I don't know what he's going to do. The op-ed has not appeared, so it may never appear. He was a little, when I told him it might hurt his historical reputation, he got second thoughts. But since the historians the history that we historians write, is much too unwieldy to be used, as I say, judges have created what has been called history light. And as I say, I think it's an essential part of what you do, or what jurists do, and I don't disparage it. But let's not get confused with real history, because that can't be used very effectively. Now, those who call themselves originalists, as Scott does, do need history, and it's they who have probably created the history light. Although I think all judges go back to history, to the Constitution in one form or another. They all use history in different ways. There are many, of course, as you perhaps know, many different kinds of originalists. Justice Scalia calls himself an originalist, and he's been called an originalist, but he's better understood as a textualist, which is a different thing. It's kind of a subcategory of originalists. Thus, he disclaims any effort to recover the intentions or the historical circumstances under which the Constitution was created, which absolves him of a lot of the problems that other jurists get into. All he wants to do is recover what did the words mean to the people back then. He does not want to know what went on in the convention. He doesn't care what went on in the ratifying conventions. He just says, what did the words mean? And it absolves him from a lot of, he escapes a lot of the problems that we have. And of course, I think all judges and justices of the Supreme Court begin as textualists. They all look at the text. They don't get up in the morning and say, now what should the Constitution mean today? They all have they're circumscribed to some extent by the text, and then other elements play into it, whether it's the philosophy of the Declaration or some other philosophy that they've concocted out of the period. They have some kind of reigning theory of one sort or another. And I suppose, and we know from what Professor Gerber just told us, that he is an originalist. But if he's an originalist, he's a very, how should I put it, a soft or broad-minded originalist. In fact, his notion of liberal Lockean philosophy is so broad and so abstract, operates at such an abstract level that I think almost anything could be justified under that kind of originalism. What exactly did the signers of the Declaration mean by inalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? And they implied that there were other rights. Well, what are those rights? Could they be the rights to privacy? It seems to me that Professor Gerber's category is so broad that there's not a Supreme Court justice on the present court that couldn't use it. I mean, I'm sure that Justice Ginsburg and Justice Sotomayor might find this a theory of constitutional interpretation helpful. It's very wide-ranging, it's very abstract. Just as the second paragraph of the Declaration is wide-ranging and abstract. That Declaration is conventional wisdom at the time. There's nothing new about it. Jefferson said as much later. He says, look, I wasn't making up things. That was just speaking what was common sense. In fact, the notion that all men are created equal is voiced by a number of people, including British aristocrats, including Americans like William Byrd, who was a slaveholder, and very conservative, you might think, previous generation, but he believed all men are created equal. That's not new for them. So it's conventional wisdom. There's nothing dramatic about it. And if you look at the history of the Declaration, we can see that the so-called natural rights, which is now used by, I think, by Scott and others who appeal to them, are very similar to the good old-fashioned English rights. The English made a fetish of rights and liberty well before we Americans did. And in fact, until 1774, the colonists, in their discussions in the Continental Congress, they were using English rights. They kept repealing to English rights until one point, somebody said, look, it's getting embarrassing that we keep referring to English rights. We're on the verge of breaking from England. We better start calling these, and this is explicit, we better start calling these rights natural rights. It's not something that came out, they just decided it would be more pragmatic and more effective to change the word. But for the most part, they're talking about good old English rights. Rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That's not really antithetical to anything an Englishman, a liberal Englishman, or a good Whig would have said. Now, Professor Gerber mentions my book, The Creation of the American Republic, and the way it was used by law professors, in particular, in the 1980s, to justify some sort of this Republican synthesis, which was made a big deal by lots of people. Historians too picked it up because historians need categories to work with, just like law professors. But it was really flourished in the law schools, the so-called Republican synthesis. It appealed to both this Republican synthesis and I think it's John Pocock who drove the thing most. Bailey and I were kind of innocent in the whole process. But at any rate, this offered to the lefties in the law schools, it offered a collective and communal alternative to Marxism that was native grown. Marxism was already being discredited well before the wall went down. And people were looking around, how can we find something that can justify communal action? And they grabbed hold of this notion of republicanism, with emphasis on the res publica, the public good, if you will, and ran with it and created a monster, as far as I'm concerned. I was totally taken back, as was Baylor. I think Pocock had kind of thrived in the publicity of it, but Baylor and I were both taken aback. We had no idea that that's what we were saying. It never occurred to me when I was writing the book and emphasizing the public good, because that's the literature. That's what the literature does. They don't talk about it to the same extent that Gerber might like about rights, because they took those for granted. That was sort of the given. What they needed to emphasize was the reason why they're becoming Republicans, throwing off monarchy with its manipulation of private interests, and we're now going to be emphasizing the public good. And that term lingers on in our own thinking, the communal good, the common good, or the public good. And it's left over from that period. But in no way was I denying the importance of the Declaration of Independence or the emphasis on rights, which were taken for granted and a basic part of Anglo-American, I should say Anglo-American, thinking. No one at the time ever thought of republicanism as a coherent body of thought set in opposition to a body of thought emphasizing rights. natural rights or English rights. They never were in opposition in their minds or in my mind or in Balin's mind. But they were in the minds of people who want to make history writing neater, or at least to get a handle on it, what's happening, and to law professors who were eager to find this communal alternative. At the same time, my book and others appealed to the right, to the Straussians, who also were fascinated by the founders for very different reasons. So we had the blessing of having both ends of this political spectrum enjoying what we were saying. But in no way were we intending that. I was as shocked as anybody to discover that I had created this Republican synthesis. It fit the needs of people looking for ammunition in their causes, which is what law office history is. It's a legitimate endeavor, but let's not ever get it mixed up with what historians do or shouldn't be doing. So the emphasis on rights and declaration and republicanism complement one another. They're not in opposition. What the law professors and others did was distort past reality, it seems to me. And it's just another example of the use and abuse of history that goes on by scholars everywhere, and people with political agendas or judicial agendas. To some extent, that's legitimate, but it's not something that I want to participate in. Just as I told my colleague, don't get yourself involved in writing an op-ed on the Second Amendment. Now, let's take an issue that was raised by Scott that I think illustrates the complexity of history. He says, and I'm quoting him here, "It's difficult to imagine a principle to which the founders were more philosophically committed than the separation of church and state." I just think that's not true. They were totally confused about separation of church and state. They didn't, in fact, didn't believe it at the outset. We quote Jefferson's letter to the Danbury Baptists of 1802, where he uses the term wall of separation. But Jefferson's an outlier. He's way over to the left on this issue. Nobody agreed with him. And he ran into real trouble when he suggested any of the things that he suggested earlier in his Notes on Virginia and his Bill for Religious Freedom. And he learned enough to, generally speaking, clam up. Every one, of course, of the founders believed in liberty of conscience. Nobody's being hanged on Boston Common anymore for their religious beliefs, as they had been a century earlier. So everyone believes in the freedom of religious conscience, but separation of church and state is a totally different thing. Now, Jefferson believed in it, Madison believed in it, but they're unusual, if not unique. Now, to be sure, the official establishment of the Church of England that existed in half a dozen colonies was immediately disestablished, eliminated in 1776, 1777 in these state constitutions, which, by the way, are far more important than the federal constitution because they create all of the basics that lay the basis for the federal constitution. But the revolutionary state constitutions of Maryland, South Carolina, Georgia authorized their state legislatures to create, in place of the Anglican Church, a kind of multiple establishment of a variety of religious groups using tax money to support what was called the Christian religion. So you're going to have, that's not separation of church and state, it's just a destruction of the Anglican Church's monopoly. But you're going to have tax-supported Christian churches, Protestant Christian churches, not Catholic. Many of the other state constitutions provided for religious tests for office holders. Six states, New Hampshire, Connecticut, New Jersey, the two Carolinas, and Georgia required office holders to be Protestant. Maryland and Delaware said Christians. Only Christians could be office holders. Pennsylvania and South Carolina, their officials had to believe in one God and in heaven and hell. They had taken an oath. Delaware required a belief in the Trinity. This is not separation of church and state. And of course, Connecticut and Massachusetts maintained their religious establishments, that is, tax money going to the Congregational Church, well into the second and third decades of the 19th century. Religion was everywhere in the documents of the period. The peace treaty with Great Britain in 1783, for example, opened with language familiar to British statesmen and to the devout Anglican George John Jay, who was instrumental in writing this peace treaty. It began in this way: in the name of the holy and indivisible Trinity. Even Jefferson, as president, did not quite believe in that wall of separation. He went to church as president every Sunday, which was held in the House of Representatives. Talk about separation of church and state. Even though there were church buildings available, he knew that if he tried to not go to church, it would create some kind of a storm, and his presidency would be affected. We also have to remember, and this we forget about, that the Bill of Rights applied then only to the federal government. The states could continue to do whatever they wanted to do as far as religion was concerned. And as I say, many of them, had all kinds of provisions for religious tests and maintained the religious establishments, Connecticut and Massachusetts, into the 19th century. Only in 1925, really within just not that far away, less than a century, did the court decide to begin incorporating some of the Bill of Rights into the 14th Amendment in order to somehow reach through the 14th Amendment and incorporate some of these rights and apply them to the states. And that's only in 1925. That's called the Dorr, and you all know about that, you're law students, the Doctrine of Incorporation. I asked Scott whether Justice Thomas believes in the Doctrine of Incorporation, and he has his doubts that he does. He's the only member of the court that does. I attended a speech by Scalia 2 years ago at George Washington University, and one of the students, or law students there, asked Justice Scalia, "Do you believe in the Doctrine of Incorporation?" And Scalia pauses with a big grin on his face. He says, "Look, I'm an originalist, I'm a textualist, but I'm not stupid." Because he says it's 70 years of precedent, who's going to overthrow that? But it is a really important, extraordinary kind of interpretation of the 14th Amendment. And you have to realize that for all through the, and Marshall, of course, denies at a very important case in, I think it's 1833, that the Bill of Rights has any application to the states. So it took a very imaginative reading of the 14th Amendment to begin to apply the religious clause and the freedom of press and so on to the states. The court has labored in this particular issue to define what is permissible and what is impermissible, and what has become, I think, an increasingly capricious relationship between church and state. As you perhaps know, and maybe I'm just speaking to the choir here, but the Ten Commandments can be displayed in some public arenas, but not in others. School prayers are impermissible if sponsored by the administration, but perhaps not if they are sponsored by the students. Observing religious holidays in the public schools is impermissible, but excusing students from attending school on their religious holidays is permissible. It's this perplexing atmosphere, I think, which I think goes back to the confusion of the founding. This perplexing atmosphere in the public schools that the teachers there has become so confused, so scared of violating what they don't really know is the law, and nobody really knows what it is on any particular issue, that they've decided best not to talk about religion at all. And that, of course, in the public schools, is the complaint of many conservatives and others, that religion's been driven from the public arena. Nobody knows what the wall of separation really means. Now, I don't want to single out Scott in his particular use of history. I think it's essential. He's a law professor, not a historian. And his need for history is different from mine, as the need that you may have, or jurists or attorneys may have. But I do want to emphasize that we can't solve our current disputes over religion, for example, by looking back to the actual historical circumstances of the founding. Those circumstances are just too complicated, too confusing, and too biased towards Protestant Christianity to be used in the courts today. You just simply can't use the founding. It's too distant from us. And most of these circumstances work against our particular 21st century needs. We do not and cannot base our constitutional jurisprudence on the historical reality of the founding. Our constitutional jurisprudence has to rest on a historical fiction. And again, I emphasize, it's a necessary fiction. And it doesn't mean that it's wrong. It's not true in the sense that I consider it true, but it's necessary, and it's created by you, jurists, and it has its own integrity. But let's not ever get it mixed up with real history. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Gerber and Dr. Wood. That was very entertaining and very enlightening. At this time, the Federalist Society is going to entertain a round of question and answers, as we always do. We think discourse is the best way to enlightenment. And so if you have a question, go ahead and throw your hands up. I see Professor Lewis has jumped the gun on us. And I'll ask him, opening the floor to him first.
You talked about English rights being the forerunners or the assumed rights that Jefferson just took and put into the Declaration. To what extent were those rights derived from the Treaty of Westphalia to the extent we go back that far?
I know when the Treaty of Westphalia was drafted, but I don't remember the provisions of it. English rights go back deep into English history. It's not something that was created in 1648. I don't know whether you have a course in English constitutional history, but you should have, because that's really the foundation of our sense of rights. People often ask me, how come our American Revolution seems so successful compared to the French Revolution? And I always tell them, it's really important that they were Englishmen. And don't ever belittle that they had a tradition of self-government. They had been electing their legislators for 100 years in some colonies. They knew about habeas corpus. They knew about trial by juries. They had that experience. You have to feel bad for these Arabs in the Arab Spring or the French in 1789. What did they have? They hadn't been a French estates general had met for over a century. Well over a century. So we Americans had tremendous advantages in having those Englishmen be the ones who drew up our constitutions. And the traditions go back deep into the common law. It's lost in obscurity. We're not even quite sure. We know about Magna Carta and so on, and these are all celebrated as high points. But the story of the development of the common law and the notion of legislative representation, which is the parliament, which meant that there was nothing like the parliament in 18th century Europe. No place had a parliament. Nobody had a Bill of Rights of 1688. These are all part of our history. And as a consequence, I think we need to have a familiarity with English constitutional history to fully understand our history. I don't think the Treaty of Westphalia, although I must say I haven't read it recently, has much to do with that long tradition.
Professor French.
Gordon, if the revolution had failed, which seemed likely to occur early in its early days, how different would our country be today?
Well, I just read a book by Kevin Phillips, and I reviewed it in the New York Review. And Phillips, he started with as a journalist writing about the Republican majority and so on, he's turned to history in recent years. It's actually quite an interesting book. I'm not sure he realizes the significance of his own book, but he shows the extent to which, as early as 1775, he calls it 1775, what he wants to show is that we were already revolutionaries a year before the Declaration of Independence, and I think you can do that. What he shows is the extent of support for the American cause, and that the Brits were really up against it, putting down an insurrection. We should know about that since we've been trying to put them down. It's very, very difficult.
to put down an insurrection of a populace which is has tremendous support for the insurgents 3,000 miles away, and we're talking about, what, 8,000-10,000 miles away. We're not going to win those put-downs in the sense that any more than the British did. They were sabotaging. I mean, I found he had data, for example, the pilots. You know what a pilot is trying to bring a ship into port. The ship commander doesn't know the harbor. The pilots were subverting the British commanders as early as 74, 75, simply saying, we're not going to come in. Trying to bring a warship into a harbor which you don't know much about it is a dangerous business. That may not have been a suicide bomb, but it was effective subversion. I don't believe that the Brits had a chance. I've concluded that they could not have. Now, Joe Ellis, my colleague, has written a book that's coming out later this year called The Summer of 76. And he asked four historians to write 1,000 words each on what would happen if Washington had been killed or captured at the Battle of Long Island and the army, Continental Army, was destroyed, which was quite plausible. It could have happened. I mean, he was really. And we all agreed, four historians, that this would not have changed the outcome. Another general would have risen, may not have been as good as Washington. He did not have the celebratory status in 76 that he acquired later, and that the army would have been re-raised. There were people willing to join. The cause was not that fragile. As it turns out, the publisher didn't like this idea of this appendix with four historians, so we've been reduced to a footnote. but nonetheless, I think the point is, but I think I'm more convinced than ever that it was just an impossible task for the British to put down this insurgency. There simply weren't enough loyalists. They misjudged the extent of loyalism. They misjudged a whole host of things in the way that we're misjudging or have misjudged in Iraq or in Afghanistan or Vietnam. Putting down insurgencies is not an easy thing to do.
In the middle.
Thank you both for talking. I appreciate it.
I'm sorry?
Thank you both for coming and talking. I appreciate hearing your guys' thoughts. This question is for you, sir. You mentioned at the beginning of your talk about how you didn't think the Founding Fathers even thought about what a debate we would be having today over gun control.
Right.
But if they didn't think about having a debate over gun control, so why would they even include the Second Amendment?
Well, because it was part of an English tradition. The right to bear arms was, that goes back to English history. It goes back to the 17th century. And so that's all they were saying was it's conventional wisdom for an Englishman. Let's put it that way. No big deal about it. Nobody questioned it. Nobody thought that, oh, is it for the militia? Or is it just for the English? They just wouldn't have raised that issue. As far as I know, nobody said a big deal. He said when Madison threw out his amendments, which were essentially common law rights and a few of these traditional English rights. The only one that's really new for the Americans is the freedom of religion that's expressed in the First Amendment. Again, not applying to the states. You have to realize that doesn't come until 1925. So otherwise, the rest of the Bill of Rights are traditional English rights. Many of them copied almost verbatim from the English tradition. That's why Madison didn't think they were necessary, because in England the Bill of Rights of 1688 is a fence put up against the pre-existing prerogative powers of the king, and you need a fence to fence off this encroaching power against the Englishman's rights. In America, says Madison, look, this is a government of limited powers. It's delegated powers. Power does not pre-exist. There's no prerogative power that needs to be fenced off. We're creating the power, and we can pull it back if we need to. That's why we don't need to build. It's a very sophisticated argument. Of course, once the notion of Bill of Rights gets thrown out into the public arena, it had such resonance for Englishmen, going back to 1688, that there was no stopping it, especially Jefferson, of all people. picks it up. I mean, he writes a letter to Madison, but also to a friend in Maryland, saying, where's the Bill of Rights? My French liberal friends can't believe we don't have a Bill of Rights. And you can hear Madison groaning, saying, oh my God, those French intellectuals, what are they doing? And Jefferson never, Madison tries to, he writes back a very sophisticated argument, why there's no Bill of Rights. It just goes right by Jefferson's head. He says, what would my liberal French friends think? I mean, you have to, Jefferson's a kind of knee-jerk liberal who doesn't think through things the way Madison does. And he, as far as he's concerned, what would my friends think is all that's on his mind. Madison didn't publish his letter for Jefferson, but this Marylander did. And of course, once it's out in the arena, Mr. Jefferson in Paris says we have the and the Federalists say, we got an argument. That was their best argument, and they use it very effectively and put the Federalists on the defensive on behalf of the Bill of Rights. Madison's very shrewd, though. He finally has to agree to pass the Bill of Rights to get elected to the House. You probably know that story, how he was running against. Patrick Henry wanted to ice him out. Ices him out of the Senate. Patrick Henry controlling the Virginia legislature. So poor Madison has to run for the House. Henry redistricts his district and puts up this young, very attractive candidate, Revolutionary War hero, which Madison was not, to oppose him, James Monroe. Well, Madison has to actually electioneer, give a speech, which he hated to do. He thought it was unbecoming a Republican, not a small r. And yet he does campaign, gives a speech, and in the speech he promises that if elected, he will promote a Bill of Rights, which he does. But what he does is take the 120, 30, or there are a couple hundred, I think, of these rights suggested by the states in their ratifying conventions. He sifts through them, throws out the serious ones, which struck at the structure of the federal government, and keeps all the innocuous ones. Common law rights, who cares? I mean, and so when the anti-federals see this, they say, this is a tub for the whale, Madison's list of rights. The tub for the whale being a metaphor for a diversion. That's what mariners did. When the whale's bearing down, they throw a tub overboard hoping to divert the whale to the tub. And this is exactly what Madison's Bill of Rights was in the minds of the anti-federals. In the end, they're angry at his Bill of Rights. That's not what they wanted. They wanted really serious rights. In other words, encroachments on the strength of the federal government, limiting the president's power, limiting the taxing power. I mean, these are serious rights, which get ignored by Madison. He's a good federalist. He wants this national government. I mean, this is the way politics works. It wasn't different then, in a way, from now. He's a shrewd guy.
We're at the end of our time. We have a very full schedule for Dr. Wood, as you can imagine, so we only got him blocked out till 1. Thank you all for attending. Dr. Wood, thank you very much.